preference fairly clear.
Thank you, Minister and members. That concludes our statement. The next item of business is a debate on stage one of the budget, and I would invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Derek Mackay to speak to and to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm delighted to lead this debate on the principles of the Budget Bill for 2017-18. Undoubtedly a bill of huge importance to Scotland and also a test of the maturity of this Parliament. I look to seek Parliament's approval of spending plans that will have a positive impact on our economy, our public services, our communities and our environment. Plans that will be supported for the first time by income tax proposals made under the powers devolved to us by the Scotland Act 2016. And I also welcome the Finance Committee's report on the draft budget, and the Government will of course respond fully to the report before stage three, but I can offer some initial reflections in this debate. I welcome the committee's recognition that the 2017-18 budget is fundamentally different and more complex, and I look forward to the work of the Budget Process Review Group. The review group will consider the impact of the Chancellor's announcement to alter the timing of the UK budget, and I share the committee's view that the UK government should provide clarity on their autumn budget plans as soon as is possible. And I have raised this matter with the Chancellor with the full support of the finance ministers of the other devolved administrations. It will also reflect on the committee's comments on transparency with regard to the operation of the fiscal framework and the associated forecasts. I now turn to the principles of the bill and to my engagement with other political parties. The government's budget plans are focused on stabilising and growing our economy, empowering our communities, protecting our environment, promoting equality and improving our public services. And our plans have been framed by the wider economic and political factors that have been emerging, such as the impact of the Brexit vote, and by our programme for government. And we remain totally committed to that programme for government, of course.
Jackie Bailey.
He says he wants to grow the economy. Why then has he cut the budget of his main economic development agency by 48%?
I'll come to Scottish Enterprise. But the context in which we are operating is with a Chancellor who continues to apply restrictions and constraints to our public finances. But we've acted positively, investing in our country, and we'll use our taxation powers in a fair and a balanced way, in a way that focuses on taxing in terms of proportionate to the ability to pay, and we propose to protect low and middle income taxpayers at a time of rising inflation by freezing the basic rate of income tax. And unlike the UK government, we propose not to give a real terms tax cut for higher rate taxpayers, providing stability and continuity for the public and taxpayers at a time of considerable economic uncertainty. But I recognise that this is a parliament of minorities, where compromise and finding consensus is a necessity. We know there is more of a link between Scotland's economic performance and the revenues that we have available to spend on our public services. That's why stability and stimulating economic growth is so important to this government. So we will deliver measures such as the £500 million Scottish Growth Scheme, more investment in higher and further education, new investment in innovation and investment hubs, and of course, £4 billion investment in infrastructure across transport, public services, affordable housing, and digital infrastructure. We also propose to reduce the business rates poundage, expand the small business bonus scheme, lifting 100,000 properties out of rates altogether, and expand rural and renewable reliefs. And this budget will also help us to tackle climate change, including through the national priority status that we will attach to energy efficiency. Presiding Officer, at a time of significant challenge in our economy, this is a budget that will support jobs and lay the foundations for future growth, economic growth, that must be inclusive and sustainable. We've made it clear, not right now, we've made it clear that education is this government's number one priority. We propose to invest £1.6 billion in higher and further education, continuing the provision of free education and maintaining 116,000 full-time college places. We're maintaining investment in skills and training, increasing the number of modern apprenticeships, as well as creating our new skills fund. We're maintaining the £50 million Attainment Scotland Fund and investing an additional £120 million to go directly to our schools to tackle the attainment gap in Scotland. And we also plan to provide £60 million for the first phase of work to expand early learning and childcare to 1,140 hours by the end of this Parliament. Overall, a package of measures that place equality of opportunity at the heart of this government's approach to Scotland's economy. I've said before that I believe this budget provides a strong settlement proposal for local government, including the additional funding for educational attainment, increased capital resources, and increased revenues from council tax. This budget provides real-term protection for frontline policing, a real-terms increase in total funding to the health service, and increases to frontline NHS budgets being invested in primary care, community care, social care, and mental health. But I've been listening very carefully to the other parties in this Parliament across the political spectrum, on both tax and spend. And I've entered into negotiations in good faith in order to build the consensus that this country needs. And I particularly welcome the constructive approach taken by the Green Party. They asked me to consider changes to our proposals on income tax and to provide additional funding for local government. My latest assessments of the financial position this year and our projections for 2017-18 has enabled me to identify an additional £100 million of resource funding and £30 million of capital funding that could be provided through central government resources. This will be funded through the use of the budget exchange mechanism, updated projections of the Scottish Government contribution required to bring the NDR pool into balance, and a reduction in the anticipated cost of borrowing repayments next year. In my discussions with the Green Party, I have made it clear that at a time of economic uncertainty, rising inflation and rising prices, this government does not think it would be right to increase tax rates. No party in this Parliament has a majority. However, the considerable mandate that we were given at the election means I believe it would not be right for there to be a fundamental change to the proposals we put to the people of Scotland. However, having considered the proposals put to me, I can confirm that this government will lodge a Scottish rate resolution that sets the same tax rates as originally proposed, but which applies a cash freeze on the higher rate threshold. This change protects...
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Yesterday, the Chambers of Commerce warned that to create a tax differential on income tax was, in their words, highly dangerous for the Scottish economy. Why is he listening to the Green Party before the voice of Scottish business?
Our proposals are fair and balanced, and what some of the business community was concerned about was the prospect of higher tax rates. That's not what this government is proposing. Under our proposals, we protect basic rate taxpayers and ensure that 99% of taxpayers on the same income this financial year will not be paying any more income tax in the next financial year, but whilst generating an additional £29 million of revenues in 2017-18. The proposals I'm putting before Parliament balance the need to raise additional revenues whilst asking the highest earners, the top 10% of earners, to forgo a significant tax cut at this time of UK government austerity. People covered by this higher rate, the income forgone amounts to £7.70 a week, less than the cost of a single prescription in England. However, in return for this contribution, Scottish taxpayers will continue to benefit from significant investment in our public services, above inflation investment in the NHS, free prescriptions, free personal care, free higher education, No business rates for 100,000 small businesses. New resources to tackle inequality in the attainment gap. Supporting our efforts on the environment and doubling of free childcare. In other words, the best deal for taxpayers in the whole of the UK.
Patrick Harvey.
I haven't said a word yet. The Cabinet Secretary knows that the Greens believe he can go further on taxation and that people on our generous incomes could afford to pay more taxation. But can he confirm that the £29 million he's talked about from abandoning his inflation-based increase and the higher rate threshold will be added to the £130 million he already spoke about and result in £160 million additional going into local government services up and down the country?
Cabinet Secretary.
Let me be clear with Parliament and with Patrick Harvey. I therefore propose that with the support of the Scottish Green Party for all stages of this budget and the local government finance order, together with agreement to allow the Scottish rate resolution to come into force, to allocate, yes, these additional resources of £160 million to local government to be allocated through the normal formula distribution. And to be spent at the discretion of individual local authorities. Presiding officer, once again, this government has listened and this government has acted. In line with the government's commitments, I wish to make two further additions to the budget in line with the government's priorities. My proposals already protected the police resource budget in real terms and provide additional reform funding of £36 million to continue the process of transforming the police service and meet the VAT costs imposed by UK government ministers. The SPA and Police Scotland will shortly set out a long-term strategy for a flexible, modern and sustainable police service capable of meeting the changing nature of crime and society. But today, I can announce a further funding of £25 million within the police reform and change budget to support this new phase of transformation funded through a combination of capital and resource headroom I judge to be available in 2017-18. More support for police in Scotland. A range of measures to support our economy were outlined in the draft budget, and I've engaged further with Scottish Enterprise. I propose to provide an additional, I've got 30 seconds left. I've spoken to Willie Rennie quite enough and it didn't amount to very much, but I propose to add an additional £35 million to Scottish Enterprise to support our economy at this time. Presiding officer, this budget is putting the programme for government into effect, but I also believe it responds to requests from all sides of this chamber in a reasonable and constructive way, protecting health budgets, delivering a living wage for social care workers, free tuition, expanding early years provision, efforts on energy efficiency, increasing house building, and supporting local services. In my draft budget, I explained that supporting it would deliver £700 million of additional spending on public services. Today, as a consequence of my proposal, that figure now increases to over £900 million in additional spending for Scotland's public services. By any measure, this budget delivers for Scotland, for our economy, our communities, and the well-being of our nation. I commend the principles of this bill and seek Parliament's agreement to them. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Kezia Dugdale to speak to and move the amendment in her name.
President Officer, and I'm pleased to move the amendment in my name. Today, this Parliament has an important decision to make, one of the most important it has ever made. We can deliver on the promises the majority of us in this chamber made to the people of Scotland at last year's election, when all but one party represented in this chamber said that we would stop the cuts to valued public services and invest in our economy instead. Or we can walk by on the other side, walk by as teachers struggle with fewer resources with which to educate our children, walk by as more and more carers are reduced to 15-minute visits to our elderly family members, or walk by as welfare advisers who support those most in need face even more cutbacks. Now, I listened to the First Minister very carefully at lunchtime today, and she said this to Ruth Davidson. She said, given the pressures on public services as a result of Tory austerity, it would be wrong to cut taxes for the top 10%. I agree. Equally, however, it would be wrong to take that Tory austerity and pass it on to the poorest Scots in the face of these public service cuts. And Labour just isn't prepared to do that. I got into politics to stand up for the very people who will be hit the hardest by the SNP's cuts. And I also heard the First Minister refer to Labour's position on the budget as somehow playground politics. So can I say to her, I met with Derek Mackay several times throughout this budget process, and I spoke to him on the phone as well. Those conversations were cordial and they were constructive. And I know he knows that, and I know that he would agree with that. So I reject completely the suggestion that the Labour Party has been playing games. We have been very clear from the offset. We have been very clear from the offset. We said the price of our vote was no cuts to public services. And the more that he baits me, the more they try to bait me to say that Labour was never serious about engaging in this budget, the more inclined I might be to say exactly what we were talking about in those meetings. Because the truth is, Presiding Officer, in those meetings, this Finance Secretary spent the first half of the meeting saying there were no cuts, and then the rest of the meeting saying, how much do you need to get rid of those cuts? We won't do it after all. Completely duplicitous. The Finance Secretary said that he had no mandate to increase taxes. He said he had no mandate in his manifesto to increase taxes. And I said to him, he has no mandate for these cuts to public services either. He has given to the Green Party today to move away from his manifesto commitment on the top rate of income tax. He has abandoned that principle of sticking to his manifesto, and it leaves him open to the accusation, why not use that 50p top rate of tax? You have moved away from your manifesto once, do it again in the name of protecting vital public services. And it has been Labour throughout this process who have been the ones honest enough to say, if we want high quality, universal public services, we have to talk about how we pay for them and, crucially, who pays for them. And that is why we have tabled an amendment to use the tax powers of this Parliament to stop the SNP's millions of pounds worth of cuts to local schools and care of the elderly. Services that are the very fabric of our communities across the country and services that the Labour Party will always fight for. But Labour's amendment isn't just about stopping the cuts, it's about growing the economy. Because for Scotland's economy to thrive, we need strong public services. That means good, well-funded schools, giving young people the skills they need to compete for the jobs of the future. And it means investing in the infrastructure projects essential to businesses across the country. In this globalised world, if we are to fight for our futures, we need to be able to attract that investment into Scotland. We are competing with the world's major economies for investment and jobs. Nations like China and India are investing to grow their economy. Scotland must and should do the same. But the SNP's budget, it does the opposite. The employers looking for a high-skilled, well-educated workforce will go elsewhere if we don't invest in the greatest natural resource this country has, its people. And we know that the SNP's constant threat of another independence referendum isn't good for our economy either. And it certainly isn't good for our future prosperity. And if Scotland were to ever leave the UK, we knew that it would be devastating to public services that we all value. And that is why Labour will not and cannot back any SNP plan to impose another referendum on the people of Scotland. Not just now, thank you. And there is a different path available to us because of the new powers that this Parliament has. Powers that so many of us fought for. And it is our responsibility to put them to good use, because this Parliament does not have to be a conveyor belt for Tory austerity. And that's why we've come to this chamber with an alternative to the SNP's millions of pounds worth of cuts. In fact, we're the only party to have tabled any amendments to this budget. But I make no apologies for saying that Labour will not vote for an SNP budget that imposes millions of pounds worth of cuts on local services like schools and care for the elderly. We just won't do it. It would be a betrayal of the voters who sent us here in the first place. And I know the impact of the SNP's cuts, no thank you, from my own work in Edinburgh. And I want to make a particular appeal to Patrick Harvey here. He has campaigned against austerity his entire political life. And he has spent the months since the government published its draft budget warning about the impact of the SNP's cuts on communities across Scotland. And I agree with him. All I ask is that he maintains his opposition to the cuts to local services like schools and care of the elderly. I'll give away in one moment, Mr. Harvey, one moment. Because here's what the Green Manifesto actually called for. A 60p top rate of tax. A 43p threshold on the top rate of income tax. Those were the lofty progressive ambitions of the Greens, and today they have settled to be the fig leaf the Nationalists so desperately want and desperately need. I am happy to give you.
Patrick Harvey.
Kezia Dugdale knows fine well that if every party in a parliament of minorities was just to say our manifesto or nothing, then we would be failing the people of Scotland. But does she not recognise that what we have achieved, unlike what Labour have achieved, is an additional £12 million plus for Edinburgh City Council, for her City Council, for public services that she is concerned about this very tax year?
Kezia Dugdale.
No, I don't accept that. And can I say to Patrick Harvey very clearly, the tax changes announced...
Yeah, order, please. Order, please.
The tax changes announced, Mr. Harvey, the tax changes announced today constitute £29 million worth of new money. That is one-tenth of the money we need to stop the cuts. And it is one-thirtieth of the amount of money your own manifesto said was needed to stop those cuts. And to accept that anything less than bold use of this Parliament's tax powers is an astonishing and deeply disappointing revelation from the Greens. But let's not kid ourselves. This isn't the Greens' responsibility to Parliament shining through. It's their responsibility they've put on themselves to do nothing which might jeopardise the prospect of another divisive independence referendum. This is the truth. Nationalism first, austerity second, and somewhere down their list of credentials you might just find the environment. If the Greens vote for this budget tonight, a budget that passes Tory austerity onto Scots in the face of a better way, it will be remembered as the day the Greens abandoned any claim to be a party of the progressive left. So can I say to the Chamber, we all remember Nicola Sturgeon, the anti-austerity crusader from the 2015 general election. Now she has become the Minister for Cuts. The Nationalists who claim to be stronger for Scotland now want to weaken our public services and rip the heart out of our communities. Today, all parties have the chance to back up their previous commitments with action, to say to the people of Scotland that the policies we put forward aren't just to get through an election, but are promises to be delivered. It's make your mind up time, Presiding Officer. Labour stands for stopping the cuts and investing in public services. There is a better way, and I ask members to join Labour in that fight.
Thank you. I now call on Bruce Crawford to speak on behalf of the Finance Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, the Finance and Constitution Committee recognises this is an historic budget for Scotland. The new income tax powers combined with the previously devolved taxes means that around 40% of the money which the Scottish Government spends will now come from taxation raised in Scotland. The Scottish Government's borrowing powers have also increased to a limit of £3 billion for capital spending and £1.75 billion for resource borrowing and cash management. Let me briefly summarise the committee's view on the Scottish Government's taxation and borrowing proposals. On income tax, the committee recognises that there is a wide range of views on income tax, including rates and bans in this chamber and beyond. The members of the committee were likewise unable to come to consensus on these matters. On lands and building transaction tax, the committee considers that it's too early to draw any definitive conclusion on the impact of the rates and bans from the available outturn data. On Scottish landfill tax, we noted that, as with previous years, the government's proposals is to increase the rates in line with inflation. It's a similar approach to the UK government and is intended to address the possibility of waste tourism. On capital borrowing, the committee notes that the government intends to utilise the maximum amount of £450 million in 2017-18. The committee notes the total drawdown of £915 million capital borrowing powers for 2015-16 to 2017-18 due to projects being bought on balance sheet as a consequence of the ESA 10 ruling. The committee notes the impact of this drawdown on other capital projects and asks the Scottish Government to provide a full and comprehensive analysis of the use of its borrowing powers. Presiding Officer, as the committee makes clear, these new powers provide both opportunities and risks. This is because the outlook for the public finances is now much more dependent on the performance of the Scottish economy. There is now a direct incentive for the Scottish Government to grow the economy in order to increase the amount of tax raised in Scotland. But the way the fiscal framework works means that it's the performance of the Scottish economy relative to the performance of the UK economy which matters. Scotland will only benefit if there's higher growth in per capita tax revenues in Scotland than per capita performance of receipts from the equivalent taxes in the rest of the UK. If the Scottish tax revenues per capita grow at the same rate as those in the rest of the UK, the Scottish budget is no better or worse off than it would have been prior to the devolution of the relevant taxes. Now, given the linkage between productivity levels and future tax revenues, one of the major challenges for the Scottish Government will be to ensure that productivity growth performs at least as well as the rest of the UK. The Chairman of the Office of Budget Responsibility explained to us the defining puzzle of the present economic recovery has been that the productivity has grown much less quickly than historically has been the case. While this is not unique to the UK, he suggests that it's probably more pronounced. The committee has therefore asked the Scottish Government what analysis it's undertaken of its options for addressing the productivity puzzle in Scotland and what opportunities the new financial powers provide to improve productivity growth. The challenge of implementing the new powers and the fiscal framework would have been challenging enough during a period of economic stability, but the committee recognises that the added uncertainty arising from the Brexit vote significantly increases that challenge. A key question for the committee is whether there will be a different impact from Brexit in Scotland than in the rest of the United Kingdom. We did not hear any evidence at this stage which suggests a differential impact. However, the likelihood of rising inflation will have an impact on the Scottish Government's budget. This is due to both declining and real terms value of budgets and the increased costs of commitments to maintaining spending in real terms. The committee has asked to what extent the Scottish Government has taken steps within the draft budget to address the potential disproportionate impact of inflationary pressures arising from Brexit on households and on lower incomes, and on public services. Presiding Officer, a further significant challenge for both the committee and colleagues across the Parliament is to develop our understanding of how the fiscal framework works. The Fraser Allender Institute describe it as an exceptionally complex and opaque without precedent internationally. It potentially introduces a much higher level of uncertainty and volatility to the budget process. And our report highlights three areas: how the annual adjustment to the block grant for each of the devolved taxes are calculated, forecasts of tax revenues for each of the devolved taxes, and reconciling the differences between forecasts and outturn figures. Essentially, the annual budget is now dependent on the Barnett-determined block grant minus the adjustment for each devolved tax, plus the tax revenues from each devolved tax. You see, it's quite simple, really, isn't it? The block grant adjustment and tax revenues are initially based on forecasts which are reconciled with outturn figures once the data is available. The committee emphasises, therefore, that given its complexity, it is essential that there is a complete transparency on how the fiscal framework operates. It's hoped that our report on the draft budget will provide some clarity on the process. The committee also recognises that the operation of the fiscal framework is a shared responsibility between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. The committee is therefore disappointed that the Chief Secretary to the Treasury declined to give evidence as part of this year's budget process. We believe that it's vital that we have the opportunity to hear from an NHM Treasury Minister on the operation of the fiscal framework, and we will continue to pursue this with Her Majesty's Treasury. The committee recognises that the new powers in the fiscal framework fundamentally change the budget process. Consequently, the committee and the Cabinet Secretary have established a budget process review group. The committee has asked the group to consider a number of issues which arose during this year's process, including budget timing, multi-year budgeting, medium-term financial strategy, and transparency and accountability. Timing issues were raised by a number of subject committees. While the impact of the proposal to move the UK budget to the autumn, as has already been described by the Cabinet Secretary, will also need to be addressed. The committee has also asked the review group to explore the options for a more strategic approach to financial planning. Finally, the committee believes consideration needs to be given to improving the transparency of the draft budget, as highlighted by the Fraser of Allender Institute. For example, the committee agrees with the Local Government and Communities Committee that greater transparency is required in relation to the local government allocations in the draft budget. Due to the different presentation and sets of numbers relating to local government settlement, some members were concerned about the level of financial resources available to local government in the settlement. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I am pleased to present to Parliament a unanimous report by the Finance and Constitution Committee for consideration. In doing so, can I say that this was achieved by committee members coming to a consensus through a collective approach, despite the obvious differences that existed. Can I therefore thank all of the members of the committee for making my job easier, and the committee clerks for a professional and helpful way they approached their task. And I recommend the Finance and Constitution Committee's report on the Scottish Government's draft budget for 2017-18 to the Parliament for consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Murdo Fraser to open for the Conservatives, please. Up to 9 minutes, please, Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have to start my remarks with an apology. In last week's budget debate, I referred to the leader of the Green Party as Patsy Harvey. I can only apologise to Ms. Harvey for this gross calumny on his character. For we know today it is not the Greens who are the patsies in this chamber, it is the entire SNP front bench. For they have swallowed hook, line and sinker the Green Party's hard left, high tax agenda. They have let Patrick Harvey pull all the strings, and it will be hard working Scottish families that suffer as a consequence. Because the Finance Secretary had a choice going into today's debate, Deputy Presiding Officer. He could have come with us, drop his plans to make Scotland the highest tax part of the United Kingdom, and work together with us to deliver an ambitious budget focused on growing the economy, not just now. Or he could turn sharp left and embrace the anti-growth, anti-business agenda of the Green Party. What a pity, what a tragedy for Scotland that he chose to throw in his lot with the lentil-munching, sandal-wearing watermelons on that side of the chamber. Presiding Officer, Mr. Mackay was well warned by the business community as to the consequences of going further on tax than originally intended.
I'm afraid I can't hear what Mr Fraser's saying, but Mr Fraser, calm it down just a wee bit.
Well, they don't like it, presiding officer, when they hear the truth about their budget.
No, I don't, Mr Fraser. I don't like it. That's the difference.
Now, maybe they'll like this more, Deputy Presiding Officer, because yesterday the Scottish Chambers of Commerce described a move to increase the tax differential between Scotland and the rest of the UK as, and I quote, highly dangerous. But today, he and his government have shown contempt for the views of the Scottish business community and have demonstrated that they have zero interest in trying to help grow our underperforming economy. They might as well put a sign up at the border saying Scotland is closed for business. I'll go in with Mr Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
I'm grateful for Murdo Fraser giving way. Can I just put it into context, though, what he's talking about? A person, as a result of the decision today, a person earning £100,000 will pay £86 more than the SNP manifesto, but pay £2,080 less than the Green manifesto. I don't think they've given way a hell of a lot.
Big deal.
Mr Fraser.
Have it for the Liberal Democrats. The Greens aren't hard left enough for Willie Rennie. He wants to go even further. Now, the fact is, Derek Mackay had so many advantages with this budget. He is a lucky man. Firstly, because he had more money to play with than ever before. By his own admission, his budget is up in the coming year in real terms by some £501 million over last year. That's £500 million more he has to spend than he had in the current year. And we hear a lot in these budget debates from the SNP benches about Tory cuts and Westminster austerity. What their own document tells us is that, both in cash terms and real terms, their total budget is up for the coming year against the previous high point of 2010-11. When it comes to total managed expenditure, there is not a cut to be seen in this document. But it is not just because of the money he has at his disposal, which his predecessors could only dream of. That Mr Mackay is a lucky man. He is lucky because he has a greater range of powers over taxation than any previous finance minister. A great opportunity to use those powers and those resources to build an ambitious budget, a budget for growth, a budget to expand the tax base, a budget worthy of the extensive powers at his disposal. Sadly, in place of that ambition, Deputy Presiding Officer, we have this weak, hesitant, dismal set of measures, together amounting to a budget which tells us nothing about the type of Scotland we want to see. A budget which will see local services cut while council taxes are being hiked. A budget which cuts funding even after the extra money put in today to the enterprise network, and a budget that reinforces reductions to college places when we should be doing the opposite. And a budget that will make Scotland the highest tax part of the United Kingdom, scaring away investment and sending out a message that the risk taker, that the wealth creator, that the entrepreneur and the successful are not welcome here. Not just now. Presiding officer, this should have been a budget to grow the economy. Our growth rates today are one-third of the UK average. Our unemployment rates are higher, our employment rates are lower, and business confidence is well below the UK average. These are the key issues this budget should be addressing, but instead it simply makes matters worse. Presiding officer, if we grow the economy, so our tax revenues will grow with it. Our own research has shown if Scottish growth had matched UK average figures since 2007, the year that the SNP came to power here, our gross domestic product would have been £3.1 billion higher over the last 10 years. That equates to nearly £1,300 for every Scottish household. And if we simply raise the proportion of higher and additional tax ratepayers to the UK average, the very people that Mr Mackay wants to impose an extra tax burden upon, if we raise their proportion to the UK average, then the Scottish finances would stand to benefit to the tune of £600 million a year in extra revenue. And what a difference that would make to the Finance Secretary's spending power. Presiding officer, once upon a time, the SNP in this chamber used to believe that it could help grow the economy by cutting taxes. The Finance Secretary is far too young to remember, I think, first time round, the film genre that was the Brat Pack movies of the 1980s. But if he has time, can I suggest he takes a look at the 1986 John Hughes classic, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, where a young Matthew Broderick sits in a class of bored teenagers listening to Ben Steen's economics teacher trying to explain to them the principles of the Laffer curve. Anyone seen that, presiding officer? Anyone? Oh, Mr. McKee has seen it. He can instruct the finance secretary about it.
Ivan McKee.
Fraser's very frequently mentions a Laffer curve in this place. I just want to ask him, for a single peak Laffer curve, a point of inflection, with the rate of change of revenues with respect to rates, DRBDT equals zero. Can Mr. Fraser enlighten us whether he believes that we're currently in a range where DRBDT is greater than zero or less than zero, and why? Or does his understanding of Laffer curves only extend to sound bites, and he's got no idea what he's actually talking about?
Well, unfortunately, I couldn't hear Mr. McKee's question.
No.
Such was the hilarity it generated over the
run of time. Mr. Fraser,
well, listen.
Mr. Fraser,
sit down.
Okay.
No. I want to hear the debate, and that goes for the front benches too. Not that I'm looking at MD in particular, Mr. Swinney. Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. But, you know, Mr. McKee wants a lesson on the Laffer curve. All he needs to do is ask the former First Minister, Alex Salmon, who was never done talking about the benefits of cutting taxes month after month, year after year, in this very chamber. The former First Minister lectured us on the benefits of cutting corporation tax in order to grow the economy. For more than a decade, it was the central tenet of SNP economic theory. The question is, Presiding Officer, where was Derek Mackay when all the rest of us were being bored rigid by his former boss on these topics? Why wasn't he listening? The Finance Secretary might not want to remember, but in election after election, he and his colleagues stood on a tax-cutting platform. Alex Salmond at least understood how economics works. Who would have thought it, Presiding Officer, that we on these benches would be saying, bring back Alex? Presiding Officer, this budget today represents a huge missed opportunity. It fails to address the problem of our underperforming economy. It cuts support to local government, which means that services are being cut at a time when the council tax is going up. And it sends out a message that Scotland will be the highest tax part of the United Kingdom. Terrible. Presiding Officer, we will vote against this budget. It is a dismal, unambitious budget which damages Scotland. But there's now only one party which champions the Scottish economy. That is on the side of Scottish business, on the side of taxpayers, on the side of hard-working families, and that is this party. And if we stand alone in this chamber on their side, then we do so with no regrets.
Thank you. I know Kirkpatrick Harvey up. 6 minutes plus a little, Mr. Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, in between the name-calling and the laughable curve, I think the one thing that we've learned is that the Conservatives want to slash taxes for the wealthy and they're deeply against cuts to public services. They used to accuse us of being the ones who believed in a magic money tree. I think very clearly it's the Conservatives who are in that position today. Presiding Officer, in a period of minority government, I think it falls to the responsibility of all parties to exercise influence for the good, to make a meaningful difference. And I think that's a healthy kind of parliament. I even think it's good for ministers to know that the votes aren't in the bag when they turn up to work. I think they need to work for those votes, convince people by making compromise. And government does need to compromise. And today, the Greens have achieved the biggest budget compromise in the history of devolution in Scotland. We began that discussion. Presiding Officer.
I want to hear Mr. Harvey as well, please.
I'm grateful, Presiding Officer, because I know in particular colleagues on the Labour benches are keen to hear what we have to say about this debate. We began this discussion recognising that there was a big gap between Green and SNP propositions. On tax, clearly we had the most radical proposition in the election last year, cutting tax for low earners. Everybody on a low or average income would see their tax go down. And moving to progressive taxes as well, investing in public services, giving local councils the financial flexibility we believe they need. And we had a long list of other measures as well, from social security changes to low-carbon infrastructure. Even before the draft budget was published, Greens had been making progress, with the government committing to roll out the Healthier, Wealthy Children initiative, saving money for households hard-pressed at the moment, committing to a young carer's allowance and protecting people in Scotland from the UK government's sanctions regime. That's the difference the Green approach was making even before the draft budget was published. I will in a moment. As for the package that's been proposed from the government on local government, there is clearly a wide range of interpretations. The government rolls in a lot of extra budgets that we don't think should be counted as part of the core local government settlement. But also, others compare the draft budget, or the budget at the beginning of the financial year, with how the outturn was at the last one. We don't think either is appropriate. SPICE, our independent researchers, compared the budget this year with the budget at the beginning of last year and come up with a cut of £166 million. We set out practical ways in which the Scottish Government could remove that cut, reverse that cut, and achieve investment in public services. And it's very clear as well, from what I've been told by the Cabinet Secretary, that the proposition today does not take away from what would be normal in-year financial allocations. The cuts that are under consideration around the country at local council level, as I said earlier today, are things that none of us should be willing to impose on our local councils. Greens regard it as unacceptable, and the basis of this compromise is not, as Kez tried to say, £29 million. The basis of this compromise is an additional £160 million being added to the unring-fenced local government allocation, the biggest single budget concession since devolution. Meaningful differences in local communities up and down the country. Maybe Kez Dugdale would like to tell us now how she thinks that £12 million in Edinburgh ought to be spent reversing dangerous cuts.
Kezia Dugdale.
President, Officer, I think it's important as a matter of clarity, when Patrick Harvey has struck the deal that he has, that he's very clear to the Chamber just exactly how much of the money he has secured has come from progressive taxation. Is it or is it not £29 million?
Patrick Harvey.
I'm very clear that the Scottish Government have given far less ground than I think they should, far less ground than I think they could on progressive taxation. The reality, though, is £160 million additional going into the unring-fenced local government allocation. I believe there is a strong and unanswerable case for more progressive taxation. The SNP cite their manifesto from 2016. A manifesto which, by the way, included no pledge on what the higher rate of income tax ought to be. They pledged to freeze... I've given away an intervention already. They gave a pledge on the basic rate. They gave no pledge on the higher rate. Even a modest 1% increase on the higher rate would have generated £80 million. A small drop in the threshold for the higher rate would have generated an additional £80 million. The fact that the Scottish Government found this money in other ways is not what I would have wished. This is not a budget I would have written. But nobody who cares about protecting public services in Scotland can look at that £160 million of extra investment and say, no thanks, I'd rather just keep ranting and make no difference in people's lives. And can I say to colleagues on the Labour benches with respect to their position, how much more could we achieve if this constructive approach had been taken by all opposition parties? We could have pushed the Scottish Government to go even further. As it happens, the Greens are the only political party that have managed to persuade the government to make any changes at all. And as for their amendment today, which Kez Dugdale wants to pretend is a budget amendment, she knows very well the budget itself cannot be amended except by the government. Even if we thought that low-income households, as she wants to, should be paying more tax, a basic rate increase would affect everybody above the personal allowance, and Kez Dugdale knows it very well. Even if we thought that low-income households should be footing the bill, there would clearly be no majority for their reasoned amendment tonight. It is a pretext for them to say to what remains of their fan base how much they hate the SNP. And what has that approach achieved? Has Labour posturing saved a single council service? Has it prevented a single cut? They're reduced, even worse than this, presiding officer, they're reduced to an act of desperation, with Labour activists today spending a grumpy afternoon online trolling the Greens, pretending that we voted for a tax cut on aviation that isn't even devolved yet. Well, I can be clear that when that APD cut... does come up for a vote, the government knows the Greens are making the most consistent case against their policy and will continue to do so. Greens have made a difference, more of a difference, in the real world in this one budget debate than Labour have made in 10 years of opposition. I think it's a position that we should be proud of, and I know that Green activists around the country
will be
putting in place
well
those budget changes as soon as possible.
Thank you. Paul Willie Rennie, a generous 6 minutes, Mr Rennie.
We've all listened to Patrick Harvey a lot over the years. We listened to him at the last election. And at the last election, he promised us a greener and bolder Parliament. But after today, it is not green and bold. It is grey and timorous. We should no longer listen, however. We should no longer listen to lectures from Patrick Harvey about austerity and compassion after today's concession. I was going to begin, actually, with a compliment to the Finance Secretary. I know he doesn't like it, he might feel uncomfortable, but actually, everybody praises John Swinney for what he managed to achieve over his many years as Finance Secretary, but I thought he had an easy time. I thought he had, in the first Parliament, he had the Conservatives desperate to support them by every budget in order to do down the Labour Party. So that was relatively simple. And then we had, I was quite successful in support of, absolutely. and then we had a majority. So he didn't really have many hurdles to overcome. But now, in this Parliament, it's a tougher task. And I think Derek Mackay has actually done pretty well. I think. I think he's done pretty well, because I found him a very reasonable finance secretary. He was working in partnership. We had numerous meetings over many, many weeks, numerous telephone calls. So the discussions have been constructive. So I think, as a finance secretary, he's actually outshone John Swinney. Oh. But
here's the but.
The problem is that the SNP have lectured us too about austerity. I remember the First Minister going to Westminster, to London, to lecture everybody about how Scotland was a more compassionate, open, generous country, and if only we could follow Scotland's model. But today, they have turned down an opportunity to invest £500 million in education, to invest £200 million in mental health, something that everybody in this chamber tells me they support wholeheartedly. But today, they turned it down. They have also turned down the opportunity to invest significantly in our colleges and in our schools, and also to clear up the mess from this government of the police service. The fact that we have a significant problem of over £200 million admitted by Alex Neil with the police service, all of that has been turned down today in a pursuit of an agenda that is contrary to what they promised that they would deliver. We put forward a costed, reasonable compromise package in this budget, but they couldn't even accept that either. They couldn't accept a package that was going to be bold, but recognised that everybody in this Parliament was a minority. They couldn't even accept that compromise package. So I think the SNP have missed a big opportunity. I think they are hollow with their promises, and we will cast a harsher eye over them in future years when they promise to make a big change to Scottish society, when they promise that we're going to get Scottish education revolutionised. We will cast a harsher eye on that. Because what we have seen also in recent months is the situation has got worse. The response to Brexit, what has that response been? To carry on exactly as they had said before Brexit. No changes whatsoever. No further investment in our economy through investing in the skills of the people. No further investment in mental health. No further investment in the critical bits that will turn our economy round. None of that has changed. So despite all the lectures about Brexit and how harsh it is, this government has not lifted a finger to do anything about it at all. So any idea that this party is a party of the economy, I think, has been blown apart today. But I would say the biggest incredulity I have is for the Conservatives' claims. The Conservatives who stand up here and lecture everybody else about the tax rates, when they realise now that today's deal from the Green Party is delivering, for somebody earning £100,000, £86 more. And they think that is outrageous. But then they say, not just now, then they say in the same breath, they condemn any cuts to public services. If you believe in investing in public services, you have to will the means. You have to make the difference to the tax rates. But the reality is the Conservatives will say one thing one place and something else somewhere else. And that's why they have no credibility whatsoever on the economy. But today is a big missed, not just today is a big missed opportunity. It's a missed opportunity to have a budget that will turn this country into a more liberal and a more economically strong country. An opportunity to meet the challenges of Brexit. An opportunity to invest in our people, to get the Scottish education system back up to the best in the world again. All those opportunities have been thrown away by this timorous and grey deal. Thank you, President.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rennie. Now call Kate Forbes to be followed by Liz Smith. Ms. Forbes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should first start and say I'm the PLO to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution. Back in May, Ruth Davidson declared that being a strong opposition did not mean, and I quote, shouting louder or emoting harder or a more frenzied gnashing of teeth, which is almost prophetic because that is precisely what the opposition has become in this debate. And to continue the theme with other speakers, in this chamber, we have a parliament of minorities. And whilst the SNP still has more MSPs than the Conservatives, the Liberal Democrats and the Labour Party put together, we're all minorities. We're parties elected by the people of Scotland on different manifestos, with differing policies, plans and priorities, but with one job to do. And that is to govern at all times for the people of this country. And the single most important function of this Parliament and this government is to pass a budget. How we do it is a mark of maturity, which is distinctly lacking in this process so far. So to deliver that budget, there's both a responsibility on every party to genuinely suggest credible ideas, and an opportunity for every party to actually achieve something. Labour haven't a single thing to show in this budget for all their noise, because it was just that, noise and politics, a bit like their amendment today. They've got a £2 billion wish list of budget demands and will make people earning over £11,500 pay for those demands. That's not fair. That is shifting the burden of Tory austerity onto working class people. Yes.
John Scott.
For suggestions. How the form of words that health board recruiters should use to attract and recruit consultants and health workers from elsewhere in the United Kingdom when moving from England, Wales and Northern Ireland will cost these workers money to do so under these tax proposals.
Ms. Forbes.
My response to that would be twofold. The first thing I'd say is that one of the unhelpful mistruths that have been spread is that people's taxes in this country of Scotland will rise under these proposals. 99% of Scottish taxpayers will not pay a penny more. The second thing I'd say to the member is that if you move to this country, you get free childcare, you get free prescription charges, you get free education for your young people, and you get free personal care for the elderly. So if that's not an attractive proposition, I don't know what is. In fact, the Tories have spun such a relentlessly narrow narrative of higher taxes that I'd argue it does more to scare off investors than this SNP government does. The Tories are incredibly miserable about Scotland's future. And the Tories talk about tax because they've got nothing else to talk about except for the Brexit shambles. Presiding officer, we know how the Tories would balance the books. They would cut tax for the richest to cut services for the most vulnerable. And yet the books don't balance. Under the Tories' plan, somebody in the additional rate will save approximately £6 extra a week and yet spend over £8 on a single prescription. It doesn't add up. Back in May, the First Minister said she'd work hard to build consensus and partnership, but she wouldn't do it at the cost of inertia in this Parliament. And despite the apathy and the lack of engagement on both sides of the chamber from the Labour Party and the Tories, we still come today with a budget for the people of Scotland. This budget recognises the pressure on our public services, so will not cut taxes for the top 10% of earners at the cost of care for our elderly, education for our children, and services for our society. The budget also recognises that real people still face real tough financial times, and so we will not raise income tax. And here's the news. Yes.
Daniel Johnson, please wait to be called, Mr. Johnson. Sorry. Daniel Johnson.
Would the member please explain to me why it's so unthinkable to use income tax, while her party is more than happy to force councils to put up council tax, and that is perfectly justifiable?
Ms. Forbes.
My response to that would be quite simple. My response to that is that the news flashes that real people out there in the real world who are not interested in our political rhetoric are struggling to make ends meet. And Labour's plans would mean that those earning over £11,500 would start paying tax. That is shifting tax for the working class people to pay the more. So we have not increased taxes. But I want to close with a reminder of what other parties may find themselves voting
Members
against.
Members in their last 30 minute
seconds. I want to close with a reminder of what other parties may find themselves voting against tonight. Because in saying no to this budget, you are saying no to over £100 million in digital infrastructure and delivering super-fast broadband. You're saying no to over £470 million of direct capital investment to deliver 50,000 affordable homes. No to £47 million to mitigate the effects of the bedroom tax. No to continued dualling of the A9 and improving the A82. No to £1 billion on mental health. And if you can tell the people of Scotland that you said no to these things, then you're a braver person than I am.
Thank you. I call Liz Smith. Do we follow by Ashton and Liz Smith, please?
Thank you. Can I set the points that I want to make in this debate in the context of the three conclusions that were drawn on page 11 of the Education and Skills Committee draft budget report, which relate to higher education? These conclusions not only reflect the concerns which were raised by Audit Scotland in its 2016 report into higher education, the evidence that is submitted to the Parliament's Audit Committee, and the recent statements that have been made by University Scotland, but they also raise serious questions about the criteria by which the Scottish Government is making its judgment call on higher education policy. In the first of these conclusions on page 11, the committee says it is unclear how a cash funding reduction of 1.3% in higher education resource matches a commitment to protect core research and teaching grants. This concern, however, has been dismissed by the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills when he says that the Scottish Government was protecting cash terms teaching and research because the capital budget was increasing by £20 million. And furthermore, he claims that the recent changes that have allowed universities to increase their revenues, and that in turn has obviously helped them to increase their reserves and increase profitability. But it isn't right at all for the Cabinet Secretary to argue that he is protecting budgets on the basis that it is possible for universities to make up the financial shortfalls by raising more of the money on their own via private means. The irony is, of course, that the Scottish Government's changes are because Scottish universities are now able to charge higher fees from rest of the UK students. And it lays bare the fact that the percentage share of total sector income given by the government by the Scottish Funding Council is constantly falling, from 41% of the total sector in academic year 2005-06 to 34% in academic year 2014-15. And it's what's led Alistair Sim and indeed Audit Scotland to make the point that for publicly funded activity, universities are being funded below cost, just around the 90% mark. So when the Scottish Government claims that it is protecting the core teaching grant, the research grant, and also for widening access and free higher education, it is doing so without explaining the true context of the sector. And that is the main point of the committee's second conclusion on page 11, when it says that despite the legitimate expectation for private bodies to augment core provision of services with its own income, the Scottish Government has not produced a satisfactory rationale to explain its budget choices. That, Presiding Officer, I would suggest is simply not good enough. But let me deal with the most... Yes, of course.
Mr Swinney.
I'm grateful to Liz Smith for giving way. The long and the short of the point she's making is that she believes that the universities should be given more money by the government. Now, the Conservatives have argued for a reduction in tax which would come into effect on the 1st of April. And I know they argue for that to be a device to grow the economy. But on the 1st of April, we have to give a budget to the universities. So how would we fund Liz Smith's increase in contribution to the universities if we've reduced the money available by cutting tax on the 1st of April?
Liz Smith.
For the simple reason that you've got £500 million extra, plus you know that our policy... You know exactly what our policy reaction is to that. But can I just come on to one point, Mr Swinney?
Please sit down, Mr Swinney.
I'll let you get in again. Why is it that Scottish universities, University of Scotland, the Auditor General and several other experts in the field are all maintaining, one after the other, that this sector is not sustainably funded? I'll give way to Mr Swinney.
Mr Swinney.
I've spent 2.5 hours explaining to the committee this morning my view about why the university sector is sustainably funded, so I've dealt with that question. But the point I want to come at is the issue, the response from Liz Smith to my intervention. Liz Smith said we had £500 million, which has been allocated to other areas of expenditure. So if Liz Smith wants to spend more money on the universities and she wants to cut taxes, where is the money coming from the Conservatives, to fund the universities?
Liz Smith.
Mr Swinney knows over a long period of time that we have supported additional money coming in from a grant... Let me finish. You know very well that we have a policy that will bring in additional money without increasing tax, without cutting college budgets, which has been a policy of the SNP, because we would aspire to a graduate contribution. Mr Swinney knows that. Yeah, and we are very, very happy indeed.
Can I ask members not to debate across the chamber but through interventions, Mr Swinney? Thank you. No, I'll give you extra time, Ms Smith.
Mr Swinney, I think I heard from a sedentary position just now that's going to put people off. I don't think it is, because you well know that down south, when it comes to bursary support, that the fee issue has not put people off at all coming into higher education. And at this morning's audit committee, Mr Swinney, you found it very difficult indeed to rebut the charge that is coming from the university sector about a sustainable funding. I won't, if you don't mind. I want to make a little bit of progress. Because Mr Swinney has to answer the point that this sector feels badly underfunded just now. In relation to the policy developments that the Scottish Government has set out for them. That's the key point. And until the Scottish Government recognises that, there is going to be a bad hit on our competitive ability and on our ability to retain the academic excellence. That is the point, Mr Swinney, that your government has to answer. And at the moment, there is no answer whatsoever. And I leave it at that point.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I call Ash Denham to be followed by Colin Smith. Ms Denham.
Presiding Officer, Over the past several weeks, we in this Parliament have, in consideration of the draft budget, been challenged to think about the kind of country we want Scotland to be. Budget decision making, as we've heard today in the Chamber, will rarely breed harmony. But I would suggest that the majority of us in this Chamber should be able to find some common ground in a document that charters a fair Scotland within the challenging context of Westminster austerity. After all, this is a budget that invests £60 million to expand free early learning and childcare while exempting 100,000 small businesses from business rates. This is a budget that delivers record investment into the NHS while limiting fewer than 10% of properties to the large business supplement. This is a budget that provides £120 million for local schools whilst ensuring that 99% of adults pay no more income tax. These elements illustrate what the SNP government has set out to do: invest in our vital social services and invest in growing our economy. Protecting and expanding our social infrastructure is so important because it demonstrates our priority of addressing the real problems that are faced by real people. And that is why we are investing to grow free childcare, increasing it to 30 hours a week by 2020. This leap forward in hours will benefit children, working parents, those who maybe need to access education or training in order to return to work, or it could benefit entrepreneurial parents if they want to set up a business. Such investment is critical in the UK, where childcare costs are among the most expensive in Europe. The government is also maintaining education as a top priority. That £120 million going to local schools is £20 million more than the government previously announced, and schools will have discretion and creativity of approach for how to use those funds to benefit in the classroom. This budget also delivers on what every party in this chamber called for: the protection of and investment into our NHS. The SNP has put forth the boldest NHS investments yet, an increase of £304 million, elevating the total health revenue budget to £12.7 billion. And I think of my constituents in Edinburgh Eastern. I will.
Jackie Bailey. I would genuinely be grateful to know from the member how she squares this kind of boost of the biggest amount of health spending in all time compared to the fact that Greater Glasgow and Clyde are saying that they have to cut £333 million from their budget.
Ash Denham.
Aware, this budget provides an increase in
microphone, please, for Ms. Denham. Thank you.
For local services and the announcements today of additional funding, perhaps Labour should consider engaging in the process more constructively, because their voters must at this point be wondering. Nothing from the Labour Party in terms of constructive comments. What is the relevance of Scottish Labour? I think of my constituents in Edinburgh Eastern and how much the NHS investments will serve them. Edinburgh alone is going to benefit from a new elective care centre, a new national trauma centre, a new sick children's hospital and Department of Clinical Neurosciences, and a redevelopment of the Royal Edinburgh Hospital. In fact, NHS Lothian will see £1.3 billion of investment. And this is precisely the kind of care that Scots deserve and expect under this government. And that is why, with 47% of the vote, they sent the SNP to Holyrood with a mandate to pass these policies. This is a directive we cannot ignore. And I am proud to stand here and defend this budget, knowing that not only my constituents in Edinburgh Eastern will get the best in health and social services, but that all of Scotland will. As such, now is not the time to give a tax cut to our highest earners, as the Tories would have. Certainly.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. She said she was proud to support this budget. Can I ask, is she prouder to support this budget that's stacked up by the Green Party rather than the one that Derek Mackay proposed in December?
Just wondering.
Ms. Denham.
Which one?
Clearly, a minority government will have to make compromises. I would assume even the Conservatives would understand that. And we certainly won't be taking any lessons from the Tories on the economy, as they're about to drag us off a Brexit cliff edge. Such tax policy would shred Scotland's social fabric and impede investments to grow our economy. Indeed, the Tories may not see the societal damage that their policies inflict, but voters in Scotland are well aware, and they expect a budget with the manifesto commitments that they voted for, commitments made to help people prosper in their lives and not fall behind. And that is why we would do well in this chamber to think of the working parent who can never manage to get ahead because they don't have access to free childcare, the bright young student who can't afford to go to university, or to think of the pensioner who needs personal care to allow a dignified retirement in their own home. We have a democratic and a moral mandate, an expectation that the parties with members elected to this chamber will respect this parliament and its processes, a presumption to engage constructively and responsibly, and this, I feel, has been lacking. But the SNP will not let our democratic and moral commitments falter. I see I'm running out of time, so I'll have to skip ahead to the end. Presiding Officer, in reflecting on the kind of country we wish to be, these are the tenets that we should strive for. I think many in this chamber across the different parties can agree to that, and that is why I ask them to join me today in voting for this budget.
Thank you. Colin Smith, followed by Ivan McKee. Mr Smith, please.
The Presiding Officer, can I refer members to my declaration of interest where it states I'm a local councillor? Now, during last week's Labour debate on the budget, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance made a very telling comment. He said at the end of the debate, we're in a parliament, not a council chamber. Maybe the debate should have been conducted in that way. It seems over 1,200 men and women who serve their communities as local councillors across Scotland, over 360 of whom are SNP, aren't capable of the same level of debate as Mr Mackay. Now, that's men and women of all political persuasions and none currently wrestling with the tough, painful decisions of which of the services in their communities to cut and which of their neighbours' jobs should be axed. I'll give way to Mr Stewart. Yeah.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Mr Smith for giving way. Would he welcome the fact that between them, Mr Harvey and the Cabinet Secretary for Finance has come up with an extra £5.114 million for Dumfries and Galloway today? Surely that's to be welcome. Surely he'll be telling his constituents that that is the case.
Mr Smith.
I'm quite happy to come to the maths on Dumfries and Galloway in a second. I've done the maths already, Mr Stewart, and I'll tell you exactly what that figure means for the cuts in Dumfries and Galloway. Now, men and women right across Scotland will still be wrestling with cuts as a result of this budget. And I can tell the Cabinet Secretary, when he's been detrimental to debates in council chambers, I've seen, as a council finance spokesperson, a fair few budget debates. Some I've delivered as part of a minority administration, some in coalition with colleagues in the SNP. But in that time, I've never seen the smoke and mirrors and dodgy double counting that I witnessed when the Cabinet Secretary delivered his draft budget speech in this parliamentary chamber in December. In that statement, he said, we will invest an additional £300 million in NHS resources budgets. This included £107 million for social care, which is part of the health budget. The problem is the Cabinet Secretary then went on to claim the £107 million was also part of the local government budget when he said that additional investment in social care means that in the coming year there will be no overall reduction in funding that is provided by the Scottish Government to support local government. Not only did the Cabinet Secretary double count the same funding to try to claim that health spending is higher and cuts to councils is lower, he failed to acknowledge that the £107 million is ring-fenced only for the living wage and a small number of specific new requirements. So there wasn't a penny more in his draft budget to meet growing demand for existing social care services. Now, I support the living wage. I campaigned for it for most of my political life. I'm proud to have been instrumental in ensuring that my council became the first living wage accredited council in Scotland. I also proposed that my council should pay the living wage to care workers and organisations commissioned by the council, but that was voted down by the then Tory SNP council coalition. So I welcome the partial U-turn by the SNP, but this side of the chamber will continue to campaign to ensure that all care workers, including those who carry out sleepover shifts, will receive the living wage and are currently excluded by this government. But because the £107 million social care funding is taken up by the living wage, it still means that tens of millions of pounds of cuts will need to be made to existing social care services as a result of this draft budget. And these cuts are sanctioned by the Cabinet Secretary. In his letter to council leaders on the 15th of December, he wrote that local councils can cut, and I quote, their allocations to integration authorities in 2017-18 by up to their share of £80 million below the level of budget agreed with their integration authority for 2016-17. That's £80 million of cuts to existing social care services for our most vulnerable at a time demand is growing. Never before have we seen such contempt shown towards local government and services and such a systematic breakdown in the relationship between local and central government than the one we are witnessing under this Scottish Government. Local government is seen not as a partner of the Scottish Government, but as an enemy. When it comes to properly funding local services, there's no meaningful negotiations, just imposition. And if local government dares to call for a fair settlement, the threat of sanctions is waived in their face. The consequence is that right across Scotland, communities are now facing up to the prospect of losing local services and losing local jobs. After £1.4 billion of cuts to local government in the past 5 years, the debate in council chambers Mr Mackay has such contempt for is no longer about the services to trim, it's about what services and the communities will have to scrap altogether. Now, it does seem the government will get its cut budget through thanks to the Green Party. Keeping the Yes Coalition together, it seems, is more important than keeping council jobs and services. So I would simply... I'll give way to Patrick Harvey.
Patrick Harvey.
I appreciate the member giving way, and I agree with a great deal of what he said about the relationship between central and local government and the need for more investment as well as more local control. But the Green approach has got his local council £5 million more that they wouldn't have had otherwise. How much difference has the Labour approach made?
Mr Smith.
I would say to Mr Harvey, I've done the maths on my local council in Dumfries and Galloway. It means instead of having to plug a £20 million funding gap due to the cuts, they will need to plug a £16 million revenue funding gap. So maybe Mr Harvey will tell me, along with the SNP, exactly where the £16 million worth of cuts are going to come from. Oh, I'd also say this to the Greens and to Mr Harvey. The deal you've done, as I've shown, will still mean millions of pounds of cuts to council services. And I have to say, members on this side of the chamber will not rest until every single voter in every single ward with a Green candidate at the council elections in May knows exactly who has voted with the SNP to cut their local jobs and cut their local services. And it says a lot. It says a lot about the Green Party. It says a lot about the Green Party that Patrick Harvey has spent more time in his contribution attacking Labour for opposing the cuts than he did opposing the SNP for proposing the cuts. Now, we on this side of the chamber know that all of these cuts can be avoided. All of them, not just some of them. This Parliament has the power to make different choices, to be genuinely progressive, to say that if we want decent public services, we need to fund them properly. That's what Labour's amendment does. So members have a choice. They can vote through a draft budget that still includes £169 million worth of cuts to council services and jobs, or we can send a clear message to this government to come back with a new or amended budget that says no ifs, no buts, no more cuts.
Thank you. Ivan McKee to be followed by Dean Lockhart. Mr McKee, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be taking part in this debate today on Scotland's budget at this historic time. This Parliament has been tasked not only with putting together a spending budget, but also a budget to raise revenue, part of the ongoing process of moving more and more responsibility to the Scottish people and the Scottish Parliament, a process that we believe will only continue and accelerate over time. We will be taking decisions to stay central to the future prosperity of the people of Scotland and of our economy, and we have a heavy responsibility to get this right. To balance the need to stimulate growth with the need to provide quality public services, both in the short term and in the long term. In the elections last year, the people of Scotland made their views clear. They want this SNP government to continue in office. They trust us to govern responsibly and competently in the interests of the country, but no party secured a majority, and the voters expect all parties to work together constructively to deliver a consensus budget in the interests of the country. The people will watch this process and they will judge us on how we conduct ourselves. They expect maturity and appreciation of the responsibilities we now hold, and they will reward those who step up to the plate, who understand those responsibilities and who work with others in this Parliament to move forward.
Anna Sarwar.
And he's right. The first responsibility, though, of any local member is to their constituents. So will Ivan McKee, as a representative of the City of Glasgow, condemned the £324 million of cuts since 2007, and despite the Greens' deal today, £130 million of cuts to the city in the next 2 years. Who's he going to stand up for, the Glasgow or the SNP?
Sorry, Ivan McKee.
Extra £17 million that's been given today by Derek Mackay, the Finance Secretary, to Glasgow City Council, and the extra money that's going to every single school in Glasgow Province constituency as a result of £120 million to close the attainment gap. The people of Scotland will reward those who understand that responsibility and work with us in this Parliament to move forward, and they will punish those who do not, who use this platform they have in this place and beyond to disengage from the process and shout from the sidelines. They will look on as they see the Tory party trash its reputation for fiscal responsibility. Not a day goes past without a Tory member demanding more spending in one portfolio of another. And at the very same time, we see the alternative truth narrative the Tories peddle on Scottish tax. Not just now. The reality is that for 100,000 small businesses, a small business bonus means lower taxes than in England. For council taxpayers, the length and breadth of Scotland, the likes of the council tax freeze means lower taxes than in England. And for lower earners, our manifesto commitment to a higher starting threshold will mean lower taxes than in England. And the whole package of superior public services provided in Scotland, including no tuition fees and free prescription. The Tory narrative on Scottish tax is tired and it's untrue, and it's counterproductive to the task we should all be engaged in, encouraging businesses to invest in Scotland's economy. It demonstrates their skin-deep commitment to devolution, their belief that Scotland should simply mirror the policies of the Tory Westminster government, and the people of Scotland will recognise that for what it is. The Tories' focus on the top 10% of earners to the exclusion of the 90% will limit their support in the country, as it always does. And all of this against the backdrop of economic vandalism of Brexit, further trashing their reputation for economic competence. And the people of Scotland will also harshly judge those on the Labour benches. On you go.
Neil Finlay.
Thank you very much. Mr McKee was mentioning the trashing of reputations. I've sat in this chamber for 6 years listening to Patrick Harfi's moral superiority and sanctimonious speeches. Hasn't Mr Harvey and the fist-clenching Ross Grier, haven't they just done the impossible and made Nick Clegg look like someone who is principled?
Ivan McKee.
I think what you'll recognise is that what the Greens have done engaging constructively in this process is release another £160 million for local government, and that should be welcomed. And all if the Tories have trashed their reputation for fiscal competence, Labour have enhanced their reputation for irrelevance. Labour today presents a package of tax increases, the vast majority of the money they will raise coming from a 1% increase in the basic rate of income tax, a 21% tax starting for those earning £11,500. How on earth do Labour expect to be taken seriously when they propose to punish the very lowest earner in our society with a tax increase to pay for Tory austerity? Economic and political ineptitude demonstrates why Labour is not only unfit to govern but unfit to oppose, and it shows why the people of Scotland will continue to reject them at the ballot box. Their failure to engage in this process demonstrates they have no interest in delivering their agenda, only in opposing for opposition's sake. This budget provides an extra £300 million for investment in Scottish NHS, above the rate of inflation, part of an SNP manifesto commitment to increase NHS spending by £500 million more than the rate of inflation over the course of this Parliament, a full half a billion pounds more than the Labour Party committed to the NHS in their election manifesto last year. And this budget delivers a £120 million attainment fund essential to closing the attainment gap in our schools. And it delivers an extra £4 billion investment in infrastructure to support economic growth in the Scottish economy. And it delivers an extra £160 million from the changes the Finance Secretary announced today to local government. The budget delivers for the people of Scotland, and I look forward to voting for it.
Please.
But the process of reaching a compromise in the interests of people in Scotland has been the most instructive part of these activities over the last few days. A clear line has been drawn between those who understand their roles and responsibilities in this Parliament and those who do not, and those who use this Parliament as a platform politicking and, as a consequence, achieving nothing.
I call Dean Lockhart to be followed by Marie Todd.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The people of Scotland deserve a budget for jobs, a budget to increase their take-home pay and a budget to grow the economy. Instead, the SNP are delivering a budget that increases the tax burden for hard-working people in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK, slashes investment in the economy and makes Scotland the highest tax part of the UK. That's precisely why we will be voting against this budget today. This budget fails to recognise the new fiscal and economic framework which now applies. As the Fraser of Allender Institute has explained, how Scotland's economy performs relative to the rest of the UK is now crucial for future budgets in Scotland, a point very well made by Bruce Crawford earlier. Given this new fiscal framework, what we really need is a budget that stimulates economic growth. We simply cannot continue with an economic scenario where Scotland grows by only 0.7% when the rest of the UK is expanding above 2%. We need a budget that will create new jobs and boost wage growth in Scotland. Last year, workers in Scotland had the lowest rise in annual pay of any region in the UK. We need a budget that helps to create 120,000 new businesses identified by Scottish Enterprise as being required to reach productivity, export and employment targets. Unfortunately, this budget does none of this, and instead it contains a number of measures which will negatively impact economic growth in Scotland. Take, for example, the Enterprise budget. Despite Mr Mackay's last-minute U-turn today, the budget for Scottish Enterprise has been cut yet again. This means for each year the SNP has been in power, the budget for Scottish Enterprise has been cut and is now 40% below budget levels of 2009. It is difficult to understand the rationale behind this cutting of the Enterprise budget at a time when the economy is close to recession. According to Scottish Enterprise, its investments contribute to the creation of 55,000 new jobs over the past 4 years, and for every pound it invests in the economy, it generates about £9 in return. In other words, the multiplier effect of reducing the Scottish Enterprise budget will lead to the loss of hundreds of millions of pounds to the Scottish economy. We need to recognise this, that cutting the Enterprise budget will reduce levels of new business and job creation, result in lower productivity and innovation levels, and ultimately lead to lower government revenues. Please go ahead.
John Swinney.
Mr Lockhart, for giving way. Can I ask Mr Lockhart the same question I asked Liz Smith? That the Conservatives want to cut taxes on the 1st of April, but Mr Lockhart is making the argument now for an increase in the Enterprise budget. Where is that money to come from?
Dean Lockhart.
Mr Swinney, what I would say is you have to start sometime, and what I would also identify is the... Yeah, I'm coming to that. The close to £500 million that the SNP's maladministration has lost over the years. If you were more efficient in government, you would have more money to spend. We have identified cost overruns, close to £1 billion.
Throwing it away.
So, Presiding Officer, this budget presents a unique opportunity to send out a clear message that Scotland is open for business. Unfortunately, the SNP is sending out another message that individuals and businesses will be taxed higher in Scotland than elsewhere in the UK. Take, for example, the SNP's large business supplement, which is basically a penalty on business expansion. At a time when we need to encourage small business to scale up and employ more people, this SNP expansion tax penalises business that want to expand. Even after taking into account the increased threshold for this tax, more than 20,000 businesses in Scotland will be taxed higher than their counterparts in the rest of the UK. It should come, therefore, as no surprise that the Scottish economy continues to badly underperform the rest of the UK. It's not only expanding businesses that will be penalised by this budget. At a time when the Scottish economy desperately needs more job creators, technology leaders, entrepreneurs, risk takers, highly skilled workers, all of whom would expand the tax base and contribute to higher government revenues, these individuals now face higher tax in Scotland than other parts of the UK. There's nothing progressive about increasing tax for hard-working people. Because ultimately, I need to make some progress. Ultimately, increasing tax will result in lower spending for vital public services. There's nothing progressive about that. As the Chamber of Commerce has said, the sooner politicians realise that economic growth, not hiking taxes, will increase revenues, the sooner Scotland will prosper. Yes.
Derek Mackay.
thank Dean Lockhart for giving way in his reference to the Chambers of Commerce. Does he also therefore agree with Liz Cameron of the Chambers of Commerce, who said, "We very much welcome the Scottish Government's decision to match the basic business rates poundage to that south of the border, resulting in an overall decrease in rates." Do you agree with that comment?
Dean Lockhart.
Well, I think the Scottish Chamber of Commerce and many other business organisations have expressed real concern about the revaluations of business rates coming up. Exactly. And I think for every quote, Mr McGuire, you have from business, I can give you 10 that are negative on the budget.
Exactly.
Presiding officer, let me conclude by agreeing the Finance Secretary is indeed lucky. This budget benefits from £500 million funding from the UK government, extra funding, at a time when the SNP is running a £15 billion budget deficit, the largest government deficit in Western Europe. It is somewhat ironic, although not surprising, your GERS numbers, it's somewhat ironic, although not surprising, that the SNP budget is being supported by the pro-independence Green Party. I say ironic because if the SNP and Greens get their wish for an independent Scotland, this chamber will not be debating how to spend £500 million extra. It will be debating how to strip out £15 billion from vital public services across Scotland. Ash Denham talked about damaging our social fabric. The decimation of public services in Scotland is precisely what would happen if the SNP continues to pursue its single-minded obsession with independence.
Yeah.
Can I remind all members to speak through the chair, please, and not to each other? And I call Marie Todd to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is indeed a historic budget, and it's published against a backdrop of economic and political uncertainty. More than ever, the people of Scotland need a budget, and this Parliament needs to deliver it. Conservative Minister Michael Fallon came to Scotland today, essentially, to tell us to leave Brexit to the Tories, forget about independence, and to get on with the day job. I think it's high time he told his Conservative colleagues in this chamber that getting on with the day job involves negotiating and passing a budget on behalf of the people of Scotland. The Tory party internal war over Europe is wreaking havoc on the UK economy and on our social fabric. The pound is falling, inflation is rising, and the horrific prospect of our EU citizens being used as a bargaining chip in negotiations. At this moment in time, the people of Scotland do not want brinkmanship and posturing. They want us to get on with running the country, doing the day job, you might say. The harm caused by the Tories' infamous and failed deficit reduction programme, followed by Brexit, has wrecked their reputation as a sound pair of hands in the economy. In this chamber, hearing them demand both cuts and increased spend is just the latest manifestation of their fiscal incompetence. The Conservatives in Scotland may well try to distance themselves from their colleagues down south, but the people of Scotland are not daft. We can hear the demands for tax cuts for the richest 10%, and we know where the money is coming from. No more free prescriptions, no more free education, and less money for public services. We heard this week that the UK government's policy on tax and benefits will only succeed in delivering the biggest increase in inequality since the time that Margaret Thatcher was in Downing Street. Having last night seen the one remaining Tory MP in Scotland vote against the expressed view of the people of Scotland, we do indeed seem to be right back in the 1980s this week, and we didn't need Murdo Fraser to mention Brat Pack movies to remind us of it. It feels like it. It seems the Labour Party too. It seems the Labour Party too are stuck in the 1980s. Confirming their own irrelevance by not even coming to the table to negotiate. Although their plan was to increase everyone's taxes, even the poorest in society, and that was something we could not agree with, I'm pretty sure we could have worked together on areas where we do have common interest. The Lib Dems are keen to appear entirely reasonable in public, but behind closed doors, they are entirely uncompromising and say that they will never support the budget put forward by the Party of Independence, regardless of what it might offer to the people of Scotland. I firmly believe that this is a budget filled with things worth supporting. It protects public services, it safeguards household incomes, it supports economic growth and empowers local communities and people across the country. There is much to be proud of in this budget for members of all parties to get behind. This is a budget which, as I said last week, delivers record investment for health, substantially more than any other party in this chamber offered in their manifesto. I'll give way.
Jamie Green.
Or giving way. Does she accept that growth in the last quarter last year, growth in the UK was at 2.2% and growth in Scotland at 0.7%. Unemployment in Scotland was up and is at an all-time 10-year low in the rest of the UK. Which bit of this budget fills this chamber with any confidence that growth will improve in Scotland under the deal that your party has just done?
Marie Todd.
Given that we're still a part of the United Kingdom, I'd say that's a damning indictment of the UK government's management of the finances of Scotland. As someone who worked in mental health for 20 years and who is well aware that mental health has often been the poor relation of general medical services, I am delighted to see a budget which will deliver record investment set to exceed over £5 billion over the course of this Parliament. And I want to draw everyone's attention to the budget's commitment to protecting the environment. Climate change is one of the defining issues of our age, and it is significant that the Scottish Government's budget sets out its commitment to the delivery of our climate change ambitions of reducing greenhouse emissions, investment in energy efficiency, support for renewable energy sector, creation of a vibrant climate for innovation, will tackle fuel poverty, provide high quality jobs, and ensure that Scotland continues to lead the world in developing new technologies and in addressing climate change. I cannot believe that the other parties in this chamber do not support this. This budget has made closing the, I'm in my last minute, this budget has made closing the poverty-related attainment gap our number one priority, and the new £120 million pupil equity fund shows a commitment to doing just that. It'll give teachers and school leaders the ability to decide the best way of using the extra funding to close the poverty-related attainment gap and improve standards in their school. And my own primary school, Ullapool Primary School, is set to gain over 14,000 in funding from this scheme. There is much to support in this budget for members across this chamber. It is now time for us all to do our day jobs, find consensus, and deliver the budget that the people of Scotland voted for.
I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The SNP were returned to government on a promise that they would make education their top priority. And I agree with that. Nicola Sturgeon has said that closing the attainment gap is going to be our overarching mission as First Minister. And we on those benches who have long championed this issue, of course, agree with that. But rhetoric must be matched with resource. In the words of former Vice President Joe Biden, don't tell me about your values, show me your budget, and I'll tell you what you value. And when you look at this budget, the values are only too clear, because words and promises are not backed by investment. Intent and objectives have no new money. And when it comes to education, they refuse to consider the powers that this place now has. And if you want a sign that this draft budget was a draft budget of cuts, you have to ask yourself, why are they conceding a compromise with the Greens to mitigate cuts for cuts that they claimed didn't exist just a few days ago? Now, when you look to education, it may be not obvious where that is in the budget, because the reality is education is primarily delivered by local councils and local government. Indeed, spending on schools comprises around half of everything that local government spends. So there was £327 million worth of cuts in the draft budget that Derek Mackay put before us. And you cannot make cuts on those scales without undermining the ability of our schools to deliver education. And so today we have compromise. And whether that's 10% mitigation, a quarter or half, there are still cuts. And when those cuts are falling on local government, it's our schools that will suffer. And so it may be unsurprising from the SNP that they are unwilling to use tax rise, but it is deeply disappointing from the Greens, who have stood and said time and time again that they stand for the principle of progressive taxation, to compromise and roll over in the way they have. That is a compromise that will not be accepted by parents, it will not be accepted by teachers, and anyone who believes in the future of children should not accept the compromise that the Greens have made today. Indeed, I think it is telling that Mr Harvey spent so much of his time and his contribution attacking us rather than dealing with the cuts proposed by this government. Yeah. I'll take Alison Johnson's into it.
Alison Johnson. Thank you. The member will be aware that as a result of the commitment secured by the Greens today for local government, we will be able to save libraries in Edinburgh from a £2.54 million cut. We'll restore £1 million to welfare advice, head off a cut of £400,000 to Edinburgh Leisure, stop £300,000 being cut from support teachers. In your constituency, Mr Johnson.
Daniel Johnson. Johnson.
But she knows fine well in the draft budget there were £38 million worth of cuts being handed down to Edinburgh. That's the reality of those cuts, and it's those cuts were only going partway to be mitigated that her party is supporting in this chamber. And you only have to look at the numbers to see what's happening in education, to see the reality of not just this budget, but the nine budgets that this government has passed down, with £1.4 billion worth of cuts in revenue. We've seen teachers down by 4,000, support staff down by 1,000. Spend per primary pupil has fallen by £561. That's 10% since 2010. That's cuts equivalent of over £400,000 for every school day since 2010. So you might not like our numbers. You might not want to accept the damning survey results the Education Committee has been receiving from teachers, but maybe you should listen to the OECD. Because the survey results in there from head teachers make the story very clear. 45% of head teachers say their school is hindered by lack of teaching staff. 32% of head teachers are saying that their school is hindered by lack of assisting staff. And 31% of head teachers say schools are hindered by a lack of educational materials. But it's not just the numbers. Anyone who has spent any time with staff from our schools will hear the same stories. Indeed, the Unison survey was interesting. Some of the stories I'd just like to repeat now. On textbooks, and I quote, maths resources are woeful. Every book has either no front cover, no back cover, and pages missing. Not because damage has been done to the resources, but because the school has not been able to purchase new books in a moment. The same is true as our science labs, another contribution. We have less money every year to provide the basic materials for teaching, chemicals, apparatus, glassware, and textbooks. And as one primary school head teacher in my constituency put it to me, so I don't want more control over my budget, I have enough already. I just want enough budget so I have janitorial cover so I'm not the one unblocking the loos at lunchtime. I'll give way to Mr
Mackay. Time is tight, you must be quick, Mr Mackay.
A timely point and intervention, thank you for taking it, Mr Johnson. Would you like to explain why it is then, in talking about the resource issues, why it is that you would be voting against £120 million additional resource for attainment direct to the schools of Scotland?
Daniel Johnson.
My answer to that is very simple. You should look to our reason, member, because we say that we should stick up for local services, use the powers of this parliament and stop these cuts. It's really very simple, Mr Mackay. So in the interests of time, I will sum up. The importance of education must be matched in the budget. If the SNP are going to
Mr Finlay, excuse me, Mr Johnson. Mr Finlay, would you stop shouting from the back benches where you're seated? Mr Johnson.
It is simply not good enough to talk up education while making cuts year after year and hiding behind the smokescreen of local government as you do so. This party believes in progressive taxation. We value public safe services. That's why we make the argument that we should use the powers of this parliament to put a penny on income tax so we don't have to see the damage that will be done to local services by the budget that this party has put for us. That's the difference between the Labour Party and the SNP. We believe in progressive taxation. We believe in progressive policies. We believe in the powers of this parliament.
Close
I'm sorry
time,
that the
Johnson.
Party over there does not.
Time is tight. Absolutely no more than 6 minutes, including interventions. Call Kenneth Gibson to be followed
Thank
by
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, the Labour Party didn't believe in progressive taxation when Tony Blair and Gordon Brown were Prime Minister, because for all but 1 month of 13 years, the higher rate of tax was actually lower than it currently is under the Conservatives. All we've had today is sour grapes from the three opposition parties. Kezia Dugdale marginalised. The Tories, Murdo Fraser, unhinged. Dean Lockhart, incoherent. Willie Rennie, outmanoeuvred. Patrick Harvey, the man of the moment, along with Derek Mackay. And it's a tribute to both of those individuals that have worked hard to deliver a budget for Scotland. And Kezia Dugdale talked earlier about engagement and how Labour genuinely engaged with the Cabinet Secretary. Well, I remember when Andy Kerr genuinely engaged with the former Cabinet Secretary, and he came with a shopping list to the SNP government and said Labour would like this, this and this. The Cabinet Secretary agreed every single one of Labour's demands, and they couldn't even get their own group to agree their own demands. The reality is that whatever the SNP propose, Labour would oppose. As Mike Russell, my colleague, once said a decade ago in this chamber, if the SNP invented the light bulb, Labour would denounce it as a dangerous anti-candle device. What we've actually got today is over £900 million for public services, and those increases were met with grim faces on the Labour benches, who, if you remember, in the autumn of last year, were talking about £500 or £700 million cuts to local government services, which, of course, have not actually arisen in any shape or form. They're greeting for the sidelines. And if you want to talk about cuts, remember, I was a Glasgow City Councillor when Tony Blair cut £168 million, more than 10% of the city's budget in 2 years. I was an MSP here when Gordon Brown was Prime Minister and cut £500 million from this Parliament's budget. So, and also, it's only 2 years ago that Labour MPs walked in to the lobbies with the Tories and voted for 30 billion of cuts, which is why you've got one MP in Scotland and not 41. And of course, as I like to do, I'm happy to give way to Jackie Bailey.
Jackie Bailey.
I am very grateful to the member for taking an intervention. Perhaps he would remind me that during the period from 2007 to 2011, every single budget that the SNP put through was supported by the Tories.
Kenneth Gibson.
The reality is that a budget had to go through. And see, when a budget we negotiated with the Tories, sometimes we had to change our budget by half, sometimes even 1%, but the core SNP budget went through. And I'm really delighted that the Tories did support those budgets, allowed us to show that we were a competent government, kick Labour into touch in the 2011 election, and thanks to the Tories helping us with those budgets, get an overall majority and have a referendum. Now, as for the Tories droning on about taxation, let's talk about taxation. The average council tax in Scotland is £1,152 at Band D. In England, it's £1,530. So I'll say to John Scott, I don't see a huge load of people in England coming to Scotland to escape an increase in council tax. And I think it doesn't say much for your view of doctors if you think a £300-£400 increase in their taxation might deter them from coming to our beautiful country, the appeal of which you clearly underestimate. Just as you underestimate the chaos in the English health service. Now, I'd like to look at North Ayrshire Council, the alleged devastating cuts. In 16-17, the budget was £279.443 million in revenue and capital. This coming year, it will be £303.89 million capital and in capital revenue, an increase of £24.447 million, 8.8%. I'm pleased to say, representing North Ayrshire, the highest increase percentage in Scotland. And that includes £2.925 million in health and social care integration funds and £4.392 million in additional money to help close the attainment gap, something I thought Daniel Johnson might welcome, but it doesn't appear that he's going to. So these are kind of additional resources Labour tries to ignore with its fantasy figures. And let's talk about some other areas where the SNP government is delivering. No one really has talked about the £3 billion so far today and the delivery of 50,000 affordable new homes. Or let's see what Andy Willetts has got to say about the small business bonus scheme. By giving full relief to 100,000 Scottish firms, the government has lifted the prospects of smaller businesses who otherwise face a tough 2017. And the Scottish Government continues to invest in rural housing, in island housing, and we're increasing, because many MSPs from across the party divide have asked for it, significantly the funds available for mental health spending from £39.45 million to £52.2 million, an increase of 32% in skills. Again, we're delivering on skills with with Andy Willock saying, we called for a new flexible fund to help firms develop their skills, especially the ones that need to tap the power of the digital economy. So what was announced fits the bill perfectly. On productivity, David Lonsdale, Scottish Retail Consortium Director, says, it's all cool welcome to hear the Scottish Government has listened to our calls to invest in improving productivity. The investments in digital and transport infrastructure will assist us. And Hugh Aitken, CBI Scotland Director, the commitments in this budget on housing and digital and transport will lay the foundations to allow firms to get on with growing their economy and creating jobs for the long term. Colleagues,
this is an
excellent budget. I urge everyone in the chamber to support it today. Thank you.
I call Adam Tompkins, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What Scotland needs is a budget for growth. But what Scotland is getting is a budget that will make us the highest taxed part of the United Kingdom. That won't stimulate growth. It will stymie it. We have in Scotland only 17,000 additional rate income taxpayers. What should we do about that? We should double that number and then double it again. But what are we doing about it? We're going out of our way to make them the highest taxed citizens anywhere in this United Kingdom. The top 1% of earners in the UK pay 28% of income tax that is received by governments in the UK. Those with the broadest shoulders should carry the heaviest burden, we are told, and I fully agree. But they already do. More than a quarter of all income tax is paid by the top 1% of earners. In a rational Scotland, in a fair Scotland, we wouldn't be seeking to penalise these taxpayers. We'd be seeking to double, to triple, to quadruple their number. Even if we raise their number to the UK average, Presiding Officer, that would yield an additional £600 million in tax receipts, all of which would come to this government. Not at the moment. The tragedy of this budget is that despite all his earnest appearances to the contrary, Derek Mackay does in fact understand this, or at least his officials do, some of the time. Just yesterday, the Finance Committee took extensive evidence on stage one of the air departure tax bill. It is Scottish Government policy to cut air passenger duty or air departure tax by 50% over the lifetime of this Parliament. Why? Because they know that cutting taxation stimulates growth. Air departure tax is to be cut, to quote from the Scottish Government's own policy memorandum, to boost Scotland's air connectivity and economic competitiveness, encouraging the establishment of new routes which will enhance business connectivity and tourism. This, and I quote again, not only creates new routes but creates new jobs. All this by cutting tax. Cutting tax but not cutting the revenues accruing to the Scottish Exchequer, for the new jobs will come with new wages. And wages are taxed. Yesterday, the Finance Committee heard that cutting APD could generate fresh economic activity in Scotland worth £200 million a year. Cut tax, grow the economy. And that, Mr. Mackay, is the Laffer curve, and you shouldn't need Murdo Fraser to remind you of it. Presiding Officer, why is it? Why is it that the SNP gets this when it comes to air departure tax, but at the same time has introduced a budget that fails to reflect these core economic truths anywhere? For it's not as if we can somehow afford not to grow the Scottish economy. GDP growth in Scotland is lower than the UK as a whole. Our employment rate is lower than the UK's. Our employment growth rate is lower than the UK's. Our inactivity rate is higher than the UK's. Our claimant count is higher than the UK's. Our skills gap is greater than in the UK as a whole. We have fewer apprenticeships per head than in the UK generally, and the proportion of our workforce lacking digital skills is greater than in the UK as a whole. And what I would say to Mary Todd and others on the SNP benches is that none of this can be blamed on Brexit. None of it. None of it at all. All of it is the responsibility of the government that has been running the Scottish economy for a decade, this SNP government. Scotland's productivity is likewise poor, in the third quartile, not the third decile, as the Cabinet Secretary said earlier on today, in the third quartile of OECD countries when the Scottish Government aims to be in the top quartile. The Chief Executive of Scottish Enterprise told the Parliament's Economy Committee recently that to achieve this would require a 200% hike in innovation levels. A 200% hike when Scottish Enterprise's budget is being slashed. How on earth Derek Mackay taking his axe to the enterprise agencies is going to deliver economic growth for Scotland is something that neither the Economy Committee nor the Finance Committee have been able to understand. Perhaps the Cabinet Secretary will explain it to Parliament this afternoon. Yet this is a budget when comparisons between Scotland and the rest of the UK have mattered as never before. As Bruce Crawford said earlier on this afternoon, and as the Finance Committee pointed out in its report, Scotland's economic performance relative to the UK as a whole is now a key factor in determining Scotland's budget. Do well relative to the rest of the UK and Scotland will reap the rewards. Do poorly, do as we are doing now, and Scotland will suffer. Stronger for Scotland, they say. Well, if only that were true. The only virtue of the SNP's budgetary policies for the Scottish economy is that they are at least comparatively clear. That is to say, they are clearly bad for the economy. Bad for business, bad for taxpayers, bad for skills, and bad for public services. This much may be clear, but there is, alas, a great deal about this budget that is anything but transparent. Indeed, there are parts of it which seem to have been presented in a manner positively designed to mislead. Figures do not compare like with like. Comparisons of spend over time do not correspond. There is an urgent need for greater transparency in the government's budget documents, as the Finance Committee unanimously said. This is not the budget that Scotland needs. It's not a budget that deserves our support, and it's not a budget that we can support. I will join my colleagues tonight in voting against it.
And the last of the open speeches is John Mason.
Hey, thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted that there now seems to be a majority in Parliament for approving this budget at stage one. And I think we all have to accept there is a lot of good in this budget, and I particularly welcome the continuing commitment to 50,000 affordable homes, £1 billion investment in mental health, increasing the spending on the primary care and health to 11%, and of course the £120 million to tackle the attainment gap. And I understand that £21 million of that £120 million is coming to Glasgow, and this reflects the challenges and needs in the city, perhaps especially in my Shettleston constituency, where the Cabinet Secretary was yesterday. And I believe this emphasis on the money going where the need is greatest is absolutely the right one. Let me go a wee bit further. It's all very well some councils arguing that they're receiving less funding per head than another council, but surely the stronger argument is that funding follows need, and in this regard, I do thank the Government for recognising the position of Glasgow. Joanne Lamont.
Johan Lamont.
I wonder if John Mason, as a fellow Glasgow MSP, would accept that the removal of £324 million by this government since 2007 to Glasgow will have had a massive impact on the life chances of our young people. And our suggestion in this budget is not just to accept what's already in the budget, but to give greater resources to the Scottish Government to direct towards needs and tackling inequality.
John Mason.
Well, first, we have to live within our means, and if Joanne Lamont's arguing for more for local government and to cut the health service, then I would oppose that, I'm afraid. And I would also oppose her suggestion of taxing people on £11,000 more. That is ridiculous. I'll come on to that later. It goes without saying that we would all like to do more if we had more money, but I think the government has been realistic in balancing up what we can raise with what we need to spend. I saw in one briefing the phrase cash limited being used as if it was a bad thing. But the reality is we are all cash limited, whether as individuals, as organisations, or as governments. We may be able to increase our income, but there is still a cash limit as to what we can spend on any one sector. It's all very well listing what we would like to spend on the NHS or whatever, but there has to be a realism as to what we can actually afford. Now, looking at the position of the individual parties, starting with the Conservatives, at least the other three parties, the Labour, Lib Dems, Greens, have been honest enough to say that they want to spend more on services and they need more tax to fund it. But by contrast, the Conservatives ask for more spending on several areas, and just this afternoon we've had colleges, local government, universities, more on colleges, Scottish Enterprise, all wanting more money. And either they want tax cuts or at least to match the UK. How can that possibly be? They now have two CAs in the team, and I'd have expected much better than that from the Conservative benches. As it seems not to have understood so far that if you want more spending in one sector, you either cut from another sector or you raise taxes. But if you want to cut taxes, you have to cut some of the expenditure as well. I'll take Liz Smith.
Liz Smith.
Mason for giving way. Is a third option not to grow the economy so that there's more money?
John Mason.
Well, I think it's been pointed out very well by John Swinney already that there's a time element in that, and we're looking at next year's budget. I do not think you can do an awful lot, and I don't think it's clear-cut a growing the economy either. We've all tried it, and we are all toiling since about 1707, I think. Now, tax, I would like to argue, is a good thing. Now, at this point, I would want to say that if we believe in a healthy society with good public services, improved health, cohesiveness, then sensible levels of taxation are an important part of the mix. Now, I absolutely accept that taxes can be too high, as when Labour raised them to 98% in my lifetime. But that does discourage people living here, and businesses will not be encouraged either. But if we want to attract businesses and people for that matter, we need a good education system, a strong health system, good roads, railways and other infrastructure. This is where the Conservatives, and I fear the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, get it wrong. It is not as simplistic as saying that low tax rates make us more attractive. The Chambers in their briefing admit that our income tax differentials, quote, may seem modest in year one. Well, that is fair comment. But they warn against even more punitive Scottish tax rises. Well, there haven't been any punitive Scottish tax rises, so that's not very credible. But I would agree that Labour's proposals, if going 5 pence higher than the UK, are too big a jump at one go. We do not know what the reaction to that would be, and if it led to behaviour change and people leaving Scotland, that would not be healthy. But the Chambers say that we are making modest changes this year, and I would agree with them on that. Now, the Labour amendment, at least we have some clarity this week, because last week Alex Rowley told us in the debate last Wednesday that no one earning under £21,000 would pay more. But today, the Labour Party position is different, and the reality is that everyone over £11,500 would pay more. And a marginal rate of 20% tax and 12% NIC is far too much for people on £11,000 or £12,000. I could mention more on the process. I think the process should be that Westminster sets its budget first, then we set our budgets, and then local government after that. And Westminster really needs to get its act together in how they do the budget. So overall, I think it reflects well in this Parliament that deals can be done. No one gets exactly what they want, but perhaps the public actually wants that and prefers a bit of give and take. Thank you.
We now move to the closing speeches, and I call on Jackie Bailey. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. From the start, we've made clear our opposition to the cuts to public services. Kezia Dugdale has met with and written to the Finance Minister on several occasions, and as other members have referred to, we had a debate in Parliament last week. So there is absolutely no doubt about our position. The truth is that the SNP don't want to do a deal with Labour. Remember that for 4 years, they were joined at the hip with the Tories to get their budget through. And I have to be honest, Presiding Officer, the SNP's idea of consensus is simply that you need to agree with them. Our very clear approach from the start has been to use the new powers of the Parliament to stop the cuts in full, not in part. Invest in public services and grow the economy. That stands in stark contrast to the SNP, who are content to simply operate as a conveyor belt for Tory austerity. We have the power to do things differently, but it comes down to political choice. Let me just say to the Chamber, in the face of austerity, a post-war Labour government invested. They created the NHS. In the face of austerity, this SNP government cut. Here is a government that boasts about the money it is giving health. That deception was laid bare yesterday with the report from NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde that talks of cuts of £333 million on top of the cut of £69 million this year, causing the sweeping centralisation of services. And despite today's sleight of hand from the Finance Secretary, local services like schools and care of the elderly still face millions of pounds of cuts. And that's even before we consider the SNP's fundamentally dishonest approach of double counting. with SPICE and the highly respected Fraser of Allender Institute showing that the same funds for social care were in both health and council budget lines. Rather than cutting, Labour would invest in our public services and our people, because there is no greater investment a country can make for the economy than to invest in its people. Now, Scotland's economy does have many strengths, but that can't mask the major problems we face. Across virtually every economic measure, we are underperforming when compared to the rest of the UK. Unemployment is up, economic inactivity is up, growth is stagnating, and business confidence is plummeting. And in the face of this, the SNP are in denial, pretending that everything is okay. Perhaps most worryingly of all for our debate today is that employment itself is down. Now, I said to the Chamber last week, the fall in employment has serious consequences for our country. Fewer people paying tax, a lower tax yield means less money for our public services. It is therefore self-evident that growing the economy is a key priority. Now, the Cabinet Secretary tells us that Scottish enterprise should be overjoyed. He cut them by a staggering 48%, but now they're to get back £35 million. What he fails to tell you is that despite his apparent largesse, is that there is still a cut of £50 million in real terms to the Scottish enterprise budget. So much for growing the economy. And as for the £35 million, presiding officer, this is financial transaction money. I invite the Chamber to go explore what this means, because this is allocated by the Treasury. It's only used for loans or equity, and it needs to be repaid, presiding officer. So money with one hand, sleight of hand, taken away with the other. No, I've heard enough from you already. But let me put this in the most simplest of terms so that they understand. I was always taught that if you took £100 away and then returned £40 of it, you're still £60 short. Yeah. Don't expect congratulations for making huge cuts and then putting a little back, which isn't in fact real money. And let me turn to the Greens. They have settled for a small change in the threshold that delivers £29 million. That's really the only new money on the table. The other £130 million is smoke and mirrors, shifting budget lines, accounting trickery, relying on underspends that they might need for other things and therefore cannot be guaranteed. We are pulling apart the deal you arrived at with them. You have settled for very little indeed. What we've seen today, presiding officer, are lofty progressive principles abandoned for low politics and the illusion of influence. The Greens are fooling no one, presiding officer, but themselves. They're certainly not fooling the SNP, who have played them like a fiddle. I pay tribute to the Cabinet Secretary's guile. But you know, Kenny Gibson kind of gave the game away. There was a marriage of convenience with the Tories, which they then abandoned. The Greens await a similar fate. Presiding officer, let's not pretend that this is anything but a grubby backroom deal by parties with more interest in forcing another independence referendum on the people of Scotland, rather than protecting local services like schools and care of the elderly. I say shame on them.
Douglas Ross, up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Ross.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today's Stage 1 proceedings have reinforced what the Scottish Conservatives have been saying for weeks. This budget is not fit for purpose. Now, my colleagues on these benches have comprehensively addressed why this is the case, but it bears repeating again. The SNP, aided by the Greens, have chosen to hike taxes on families and firms, making Scotland the most expensive part of the UK in which to live, work and do business. They're asking the Scots to pay more while the SNP continues to deliver the same shambles on education, the NHS and our justice system. And while Derek Mackay is raiding the pockets of hard-working Scots, he's conveniently failed to mention that he's got £500 million more to spend this year. Now, the SNP like to claim they're competent at running the country, but this budget has shown that to be absolute fantasy. Now, I see the First Minister sitting in the front bench, and I wonder if she's doing a report card on her Cabinet Secretaries after this Stage 1 debate. I wouldn't like to see the marks given to Messrs Mackay, Brown and Matheson. We've got Mr Mackay, a finance secretary who had asked my colleague Murdo Fraser to explain the Laffer curve, and I'm pretty sure from his reaction to Mr McKee's essay that there's no way he wrote what Mr McKee read out earlier on. Dean Lockhart was quite right to outline that despite these last-minute changes, there is still a cut to the enterprise networks. Now, you might have thought that Mr Brown would have spoken up against these as at Cabinet, but maybe that's expecting too much, Deputy Presiding Officer, because earlier this week we found out that Mr Brown, through an FOI request, had little awareness of the role of Highlands and Islands Enterprise 2 months after he'd set up a review on HIE. Hardly competent government. And at Justice, Mr Matheson, hold on, and at Justice, Mr Matheson, dubbed by some to be the Invisible Minister, would probably have preferred not to have been seen when he came and appeared before the Justice Committee. We were looking at the Crown Office budget, and we'd already heard from the Crown Office that they would have to lose jobs as a result of the real-term cuts from this SNP government. But the Justice Secretary said in response to my question about his government's cuts and job losses, "I'm not expecting any at present." A week later, the Crown Agent told the same Justice Committee that there would be 30 jobs lost because of the SNP's cuts to their budget. Presiding Officer, I'd dearly love to tell these SNP ministers to go back to school and learn their briefs, but given the shambolic nature of education under the Nationalists, I'm not sure they would learn very much. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, We've had some great quotes in this debate today. I've enjoyed it greatly. Ash Denham confirmed to me that she prefers the budget amended by the Greens rather than the one Derek Mackay proposed in December. Marie Todd told us that this Parliament, our Scottish Parliament, with powers over finance, the economy, enterprise, education, policing and the NHS, doesn't have the powers to improve things. Well, I tell the SNP member, I say to Marie Todd, we have the powers, we just don't have the right government to use them. And Kenneth Gibson stood up and called Patrick Harvey the man of the hour. Words that spread fear through many of us, myself included. So what about the man of the hour? How tough a negotiator is Patrick Harvey? What was his negotiation for the vital 6 Green votes to get the budget passed tonight? How much ground did he get the SNP to concede? Far less than they should have. Not my words, but Mr Harvey's own words. He said in response to Kezia Dugdale that he got far less from the Scottish Government than he should have. It's hardly the amazing deal the Green MSPs say we got. I will give way to
Patrick
the man
Harvey.
Of the hour.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way because it allows me to ask him the same question that I would have asked to Jackie Bailey. Both have said that we should have got more. Can the member tell me any occasion when any budget has been debated in this Parliament when either the Conservatives or the Labour Party have achieved anything like the scale of an impact that Greens have managed today?
Douglas Ross.
Business rates cuts. 1,000 extra police officers on the beat. Town Centre Regeneration Fund. If you want to learn how to negotiate, listen to the Conservatives, not say yourself that you didn't get enough from the SNP and then complain when members criticise you for it. Deputy Presiding Officer, I also very quickly want to mention business rates. I've been contacted by countless businesses in Murray who have been affected by the proposed rises which the SNP government is overseeing. Hotels. It's not a laughing matter, Mr Gibson. Hotels in Forres, entertainment venues in Elgin, they've all said to me that these increases will harm their businesses. And we know from First Minister's question today that even SNP members can't swallow the increases these businesses would have to put on their fees to meet the hike in the business rates. These businesses are right to expect more from the SNP and their Scottish Government. And finally, I just want to mention about the deal done to secure tonight's budget. We now know the price of dealing with the Greens. The nationalist alliance between the two parties in this chamber who want to separate Scotland from the rest of the UK also want Scottish taxpayers to pay more. The SNP and the Greens have lurched far further to the left than any of us feared they would. Well, I stop when the First Minister speaks from a sedentary position. If she'd like to intervene, I'd have... No, OK, the First Minister doesn't want to intervene. That's very telling on her government's budget. As Murdo Fraser has said, Scottish businesses will suffer because of this budget. Hard-working families will suffer because of this budget. The SNP would love to paint our opposition to these tax hikes as protecting the rich, but it's about protecting the many public servants, including teachers, nurses and policemen and women. These are the people who will suffer under the SNP plans. Scottish Conservatives have outlined an alternative approach which would increase the tax base. It would provide an environment ripe for growth at a time when the performance in Scotland's economy has never been more pivotal in providing cash for public services. Because we have ambition for Scotland, we can't support this budget while it proposes to make Scotland the highest tax part of the United Kingdom. For these reasons, Deputy Presiding Officer, Scottish Conservatives will vote against the budget at decision time tonight.
I call on Derek Mackay to close this debate. You have up to 10 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I say I was thoroughly disappointed by Douglas Ross's comments in the content of his contribution, not just because I think he showed that not only is the Tory party not fit for government, they're not fit for opposition either. And the quite remarkably disappointing contribution from a number of Conservative members today. Sorry, I was turning my attention to the Tories and it seems to upset the Labour Party now. But in terms, you know, better together's back together for the budget. But presiding officer, maybe it's a sign of things to come, but they're not just back together. They're not just back together for the budget. From what I've seen this afternoon, you are bitter together. Bitter together. What a woeful, woeful contribution to a mature debate. What was meant to be a mature debate on the public services of our country. I do think it's been quite a lively debate and members have taken a number of different positions and that's to be expected. What I've tried to do throughout, though, is to try and find the common ground, the consensus that exists within the Parliament to deliver a budget for Scotland that we could all agree to. The comment that I was, I suppose, most disappointed by from Douglas Ross is when he made an appalling attack on the shambles in Scottish education as he described it. I think that's an appalling attack on the education service of Scotland. But it is symptomatic of how the Conservatives have reverted to type and constantly, no matter the subject, talking Scotland down. And if people are scared away from investing or living in Scotland, it'll be because of the messages that they hear from the Scottish Tory party, whose day job seems to be standing up for Westminster and your hard right Tory government. But I can say, I do regret now not taking the intervention from Willie Rennie, especially if he was going to start with, I think Derek Mackay has done a good job. I now regret not taking that intervention. But I'll say of the Liberal Democrats, I think there's much in this budget that they can support. But in terms of the Labour Party, they know that their amendment is totally meaningless. It's totally meaningless. But what the Labour Party are proposing isn't to end austerity, but with their proposition on the basic rate of income tax, is simply to pass austerity on to the households across Scotland with no consideration of the risks to the Scottish economy, and in terms of the additional rate, no cognizance of the advice that says it might lose money to the public services of Scotland. What we are proposing as a government is not just an investment of an extra
£700 million for our public services, but now an extra £900 million for our public services that this evening the Labour Party won't support. On the subject of support, from sector to sector, I have a number of quotes, in a moment, a number of quotes of support for our budget. From Colleges Scotland, who say, the increased investment in Scotland's colleges is very welcome indeed, particularly in these tough financial times. We've discussed the Chamber of Commerce welcoming our business rates position as it relates to small business bonus and the poundage, and welcoming our infrastructure spend as well. Or the EIS welcoming the additional funds to tackle attainment in Scotland and inequality. Or the Federation of Small Businesses, who have spoken about how we're giving hope to small businesses in difficult times. I could go on with a number of supportive quotes about our budget, but of course it's only right that I hear from Anna Sawa.
The Cabinet Secretary for giving way. The SNP used to support the 50p tax ban, and indeed the Cabinet Secretary said at the Finance Committee that if the 50p tax ban were introduced in other parts of the UK, he'd consider introducing it in Scotland. Why is it that he's only a unionist when it comes to tax policy? Or should I say, why is he only a unionist when it comes to Tory tax policy?
Of course, Cabinet Secretary.
Because the problem is that the Labour Party believe their own rhetoric. I didn't actually say that. What I tried to do was explain the block grant adjustment to the Labour Party members on the committee. But I failed, clearly, presiding officer, to do that. And I was explaining the difference of what happens in terms of the outturn for our resources in relation to the new fiscal framework. I'll happily arrange a full briefing for members of the Labour Party that want to understand how that works. Our proposition on the additional rate was that it remains under review, but we would want to be certain that such a position would actually generate resources for public services rather than jeopardise them, which is what the Labour Party would suggest that we do. They've criticised my position on local services. It would be true to say that it's not just £240 million in terms of the potential spending power to local services. No, it's not. After this budget, with the cooperation and engagement of the Greens, the totality of spending power for local services increases to over £400 million extra resources for our local services. And a number of council areas have been raised by different members. Colin Smyth mentioned his area. His area will see an increase of £12 million in terms of local services. Kezia Dugdale mentioned Edinburgh. That area will see over a £30 million increase, 3.92%. Ivan McKee mentioned Glasgow, as did other members. Their increase is £45 million. And Kenny Gibson, of course, mentioned North Ayrshire, a £26 million increase in terms of that. So we are investing in our public services. And we're also investing in infrastructure, whether it's housing or digital or water infrastructure or roads or rail that would be opposed by the Labour Party as well, or new community facilities, or the fantastic investment that will increase the number of houses that we're building in Scotland as well. So we're delivering stability for our economy and stimulating growth with further investment in innovation and internationalisation as well. But you see, back to the Conservatives, they kept referring to the extra resources that we'll have to spend. And I've said repeatedly, and it's been backed up by the Fraser of Allender Institute, that the figures that you refer to don't refer to full discretionary spend. So I might need to do another briefing to educate many of the Conservatives on the actual discretionary spend that this Parliament has at its disposal. But you know, the most disappointing thing from the Tories, not right now, I've got 2 minutes left, because I want to make a very important point about what the Conservatives are proposing to do. Yes, you were elected to be a strong opposition, but I'd like to see you tell those you represent that you're opposing a very generous package in business rates and the reliefs that this government will provide. You'll be opposing investment in education, on our trade strategy, on a range of other infrastructure projects. Scotland remains an attractive place to live, work and invest. It has been the Tories who have been talking Scotland down, and we are not passing on your Tory tax cuts. But you know, if there is divergence in our tax proposition, it's because this government, this party, it believes in the social contract. And that is, of course, free education, not tuition fees, free prescriptions, free personal care for the elderly, the abolition of bridge tolls, the council tax freeze during those difficult times, free personal care, as I've touched upon, and of course no compulsory redundancies for Scottish Government and health service workforce, as well as of course the massive investment in the NHS as well. But you see, the Tory party are actually for tax rises, but only if you're poor, only if you're seeking education, or if you happen to live south of the border, where under the Conservatives, council tax has rocketed with a UK Tory government. So it is the case that the Tories want to put up taxes, but only if you're poor, or you're sick, or you're seeking opportunity through education. Arguably, Robin Hood in reverse as a Conservative Party in Scotland. So we believe in a budget that will deliver stability, that will stimulate our economy, that invests in education, that tackles inequality, focuses on attainment, supports every part of the country, invests in our infrastructure, listens to the voices in Parliament and responds. I believe it is a good budget. I'm very proud of this budget. I look forward to taking it to the country, and I believe that this chamber can unite, even at this late stage, to recognise that this extra spending of £900 million is good for Scotland in building a better and a fairer society, and one in which we can all be proud.
Thank you. That concludes our debate on stage one of the budget. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 3839 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a revised business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 3839. Thank you very much. No member is asked to speak against the motion. I'll put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion 3839 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that amendment 3768.1 in the name of Kezia Dugdale, which seeks to amend motion 3768 in the name of Derek Mackay on the Budget Scotland Bill, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We shall move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment 3768.1 in the name of Kezia Dugdale is yes 23, no 103, there were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The final question is that motion 3768 in the name of Derek Mackay on the Budget Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 3768 in the name of Derek Mackay is yes 67, no 59. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.